slide here is set operations, which we covered very quickly yesterday. So we can apply union, intersection, set difference to the results of SQL queries. And as I told you earlier, an SQL query's result is a relation. A relation is a set, so I can do union, intersect, except on sets or a multiset. Now, the syntax is straightforward. In SQL, I just have a query, select from where, union or intersect or except. Now, the next question is, how do set operations deal with duplicates? So, it turns out that in SQL by default, the set operations union, intersect and except all eliminate duplicates by default. Now, don't ask me why this is the default, but if you don't want them to eliminate duplicates, you can say union all, except all or intersect all. Now, what do these mean? If you say union all and each of the relations has some duplicates, or maybe the union inputs don't have duplicates, the same tuple though may be present in both the results. So in union, if a copy is present in both the inputs, it will appear only once in the result, because union eliminates duplicates by default in SQL. But if I said union all, both the copies will be present. So if a tuple was present in both the relations, it will be present twice in the result. Union all is actually very cheap to implement. You simply take the first result, concatenate the second result and you are done. Union requires duplicate elimination. Now, what if a tuple appears multiple times in the first and in the second? It is easy to see that union all, if it concatenates, if a tuple appeared m1 times here and m times here and n times there, then it appears m plus n times in the output. So that was easy. Now, what about intersection? If a tuple appears 0 times in the first and 1 time in the second, it should not appear in the output. If it appears once in both, it should appear in the output. What if it appears once in the first one and twice in the second? How many times should that tuple appear in the output? And the way SQL defines this is to say it will appear a minimum of m comma n times. So if it appeared once here, twice there, it will appear only once in the output. If it appeared 4 times here and 2 times in the other one, it will appear 2 times in the output, because minimum of 4 comma 2 is 2. So that is how it is defined. It is fairly intuitive. And finally, the except, this set difference, outputs a result if it is present in the first but not in the second output argument to the minus. What if there are duplicates? It should be clear that if it appears one time in the left side and one time in the right side, it will not appear in the output. There are no duplicates. What if it appears one time in the left and twice in the right? Again, it should be clear it should not appear in the output. But what if it appears twice in the left and once in the right? The set version of except eliminates duplicates first. Therefore, even if it appears twice, it will take one copy here. And the other one, it appears once, it takes one copy, and since it appears in the second, it is eliminated, and that is it, it will not appear in the result. But the multiset version of except, which is except all shown here, in that the tuple will appear m minus n times. So if it appears twice here and once in the right hand side, it will appear 2 minus 1, which is 1 time in the output. Well, but we have to be careful. What if it appears once in the left hand side and twice in the right? Then 1 minus 2 is minus 2. So it cannot appear minus 1 times in the output. Therefore, it basically appears 0 times. So the formula is max of 0 comma m minus n. So if m minus n is negative, the maximum will be 0. So that is how set operations deal with duplicates in SQL. Okay. Now moving on. We saw the null value. The null value is actually very important, and we really need to understand what SQL does with null values. Now, we already saw why we need null values. There are situations where we don't know if what the value of an attribute is, and in systems which did not allow null, people used some particular flag. Now, what flag they used depended on who wrote the program. So for example, in IIT Bombay's old database, this was back in the 80s, we used FoxPro, which is an old pre-relational, it was kind of relational, but it didn't support SQL database, and it did not support null values at that point. So they had a schema which had a retirement date for people. Now, when they first loaded the data, they didn't know the retirement date for people. This should have been known, but it would have had to be entered manually. So the programmers decided we will say it is unknown. But there was no null value. So what was unknown? They had a year which was 2-digit, and they wanted to do year comparison to say if the current year is less than the retirement date, they are still there. Therefore, they set the retirement date as December 31st, 1999. That was their null value, which seemed fine in the 80s, late 80s, this seemed fine. 1999 is more than 10 years away. Why do we bother? And guess what? Eventually, 1999 did come around. And according to our database, all of us over here who were there at that time were to be retired on that date. So we would have all been fired. We wouldn't have been happy. Obviously, this kind of error is going to be caught, and before that 1999 December 31st happened, the programs were rewritten and the actual year was increased to 4 digits and the actual year of retirement was put in. But a safer solution would have been to put null over there if you didn't know what it is, and that's why nulls get introduced. But once nulls are introduced, you have to deal with them. If say that a query uses an attribute value which is null, have to be explicit in the SQL semantic as to what will happen. I cannot say, well, do whatever you want. I have to say explicitly what happens. So to do that, I have to see the impact of null on each operation in SQL. We'll start with the most primitive operation, which are expressions. So let's start with arithmetic expression. If I say 5 plus null, what should it be? I have 5, which I know. I'm adding to it an unknown value. I don't know what the result should be. Therefore, 5 plus null will come out to be null in SQL. Now, what about other operations? I'm not going to list all of them, but I suggest you try it out. You can write an SQL query which says select 5 plus null from some small relation. Let's say what is the smallest relation you have, so because you will get duplicates. You can create a new relation with just one record in it. So it has to have one record at least. And then let's call this temp. In Oracle, there is such a relation called dual, which many people use. It's nothing but a relation which has one tuple. And you generally don't actually access its attributes. It's for writing queries which work on constant expression. So as I say select 5 plus null from this relation dual. In PostgreSQL, it doesn't exist, but you can create it and see what is the result. Similarly, in today's lab, I suggest you try out other things. If I say the string, let's say John, concatenate it with null, find out what happens. It's worth trying this. So that is for arithmetic and string expressions. Now, what about other things which are predicates? We are going to come to that in the next slide. If I say 5 less than null, what is the result? So that is coming up in the next slide. But before that, SQL lets us check explicitly for null by saying, for example, select name from instructor where salary is null. So these are all instructors whose salaries I don't know, the database doesn't know. What if I said select name from instructor where salary equals null? Now, equal null doesn't have any meaning because null stands for unknown. Unknown equal to unknown? Well, you know, the unknown value may be 5, it may be 10. So I can't say null is equal to null. 5 may not be equal, 5 is not equal to 10. I don't know what they are. It may be that both the nulls actually represent 5, but I don't know. Therefore, if I say something equal to null, if it will basically say I don't know the result. The equal will say unknown. So if I want to check if a value is null, I have to say is null in SQL, special syntax. I cannot say equal to null. So that is the query here. I can also say is not null, which will be the opposite. Now, coming to comparisons with nulls, if I had an attribute value which was null and my selection condition was 5 less than r dot a, what happens? R dot a is null, therefore, I am actually evaluating 5 less than null. Is 5 less than null? I can't say. Maybe null was 4, in which case it's false. Maybe null was 6, in which case it's true. I don't know. Now, similarly, null equal to null or null not equal to null, all of these we don't know. So, really we should say we don't know. But if you take Boolean logic, which has only true or false, it does not have any value called unknown. Therefore, if you stuck with Boolean logic, you will have to say true or false, and this causes problems. If I say it's true, obviously it's wrong. So maybe I can say it's false. 5 less than null is false. That also causes a problem. Do I have an example here? But let me bring it up on the slides here. Okay. So now let's take this query, which says select star from R, where R dot A is less than 5. Okay. So, I will say if it is false, then that tuple will not appear in the result. That is, if R dot A is null, where R dot A equal to null, null less than 5, if I say it is false, then I get a result which is acceptable in the sense that that particular R tuple will not appear in the result. But now, supposing I write a slightly different query, instead of writing R dot A less than 5, I could say not R dot A greater than or equal to 5. Now, you would expect that these two conditions in the two boxes here should be the same. In normal algebra, they are the same. R dot A less than 5 is really the same as not R dot A greater than or equal to 5. But let's see what happens if R dot A is null. I cannot say that R dot A greater than or equal to 5. So supposing I say false, what happens? This is false. Not of false is true. So now look what happened. If R dot A is null, the first one here would evaluate to false, while this one here would evaluate to true. Now that's a problem. These two should have been the same value, but suddenly they are not. Depending on how you write the query, you get two different results. That's rather disturbing. And it turns out the problem is that our Boolean algebra forced us to say that this is either true or false. The solution is to introduce a new value called unknown. So what we are going to say is if we say R dot A less than 5 and R dot A is null, we will say that the result is unknown. So now what do we do with this unknown result? So note, look at the third bullet here, which says not of unknown equal to unknown. So R dot A less than 5, unknown. Not R dot A greater than equal to 5, well, R dot A greater than equal to 5 is also unknown. Not of unknown is unknown. So what I have just done is using three valued logic, which includes a new truth value unknown, these two things which were different earlier are now both the same, unknown. Now, how do you deal with unknown in general with other operations and or? Well, this truth table shows it. So, unknown or true? Well, it's very clear that whether unknown is true or false, whatever it turns out, or true has to be true. Therefore, the result of unknown or true is true. Now, how about unknown or false? Now, the false part is certainly not going to make it true, but the unknown, depending on whether it's true or false, the result would be true or false. So I cannot say which it is. Therefore, unknown or false is unknown. Similarly, unknown or unknown is unknown. I can't say what it is. Now, what about and? True and unknown? Can I say it's true? No. If unknown is true, it's true. If unknown is false, true and false is false. So the result of true and unknown is unknown. How about false and unknown? Now whether unknown is true or false, false with anything is false. Therefore, false and unknown I can say is false. And how about unknown and unknown? Well, again I can't say anything. The unknowns may have been true or false, and therefore I'll say the result is unknown. So what we have just done is Boolean logic with unknowns. Well, so far so good, but that doesn't tell me what to do with the result of an SQL query with this thing appearing. One other construct. SQL has an explicit control called is unknown, which evaluates to true if the predicate P evaluates to unknown. Okay, so that wraps up the three-valued logic, but that has not solved the overall problem yet. If the query had a condition where r dot a less than 5, and I evaluate this, and for a particular tuple, the result is unknown. Now, should that tuple appear in the result of the query or not? The where clause condition said r dot a less than 5, I don't know whether it's true or false. So, conceptually, the tuple may appear or it may not appear, we are not sure. So people have actually worked on versions of relational algebra where a tuple's presence in a result is itself uncertain, it may or may not be present. However, this complicates the semantics and query processing and many other things tremendously. So SQL decided not to go that far. It said a relation is deterministic, either a thing is present or it is absent. Therefore, what it does is, it pushes the unknown along as far as it can. So as long as it's evaluating a predicate, it will keep the three-valued logic with unknowns. But at the end, when it has to make a decision on whether a particular tuple satisfies the predicate or not, it will only output tuples where the predicate evaluates to true. If the predicate evaluates to false, it's out. If it evaluates to unknown, again the tuple is out. So what SQL is doing is saying, I will only output tuples which I am sure are true. If it's unknown, it will not be in the query result. So that is a limitation which is forced because of efficiency considerations. So this is a good point to take a break, and we have another quiz question. So don't answer the questions yet. Just press the ST button, and meanwhile, let's see the questions. Consider the two predicates, r dot a less than 5. Yeah, we will see. Let you get it up, and we will also see the response for the previous question. So go ahead and set it up. So this question is r dot a less than 5 and r dot a is not null. The question is, are the two equivalent? Equivalent only if r dot a cannot be null, are equivalent only if r dot a is null, or are never equivalent? So you have some time to answer it. Don't answer it at this point. Before you do, we will get the response for the previous query setup. We'll see it and then set up the current query. The question was, if you omit the order by clause, there are several options. The first option is, there is no default ordering. That is true. If you omit the order by, the SQL system can choose whatever ordering it wants. The second alternative was, the result may turn out to be ordered. In fact, this is also true. The SQL engine may choose a particular way of evaluating it, which results in some order. Maybe it ends up, if you have a query on instructor, it may turn out that the SQL engine chose to sort instructors by their ID, and the result may happen to be sorted by ID. But that's not guaranteed. If you run the same query on a different database engine, it may very well give you a different sort order. Or if you move to a different version of the same database engine, it may give you a different sort order. So if you need a sort order, don't depend on what happens to show up, but you have to explicitly sort. So in fact, 1 and 2 are both true. So the correct answer is 3 or C, which is both the above are true. 4, which says neither 1 nor true, is obviously wrong. Now, what are the results? Today the audience has lost. Quite a few have said 1 is true. Most probably you saw that 1 is true and immediately pressed A. So this tells you should read your questions carefully, because you were partially right. 1 is true, but it's not the only true answer. several have said 2 is true, which is again a similar state where it is true, but it is not the best choice. And third place was the correct answer C, which is both are true, and roughly tied for the first place is D, which is also wrong. So please read the alternatives carefully next time around. So I hope audience will get back to its winning ways and stop losing. Okay, now let's come back to the current question. Please read the question while we enable the quiz. I'll tell you when you can answer it. All of you, please press ST. Don't press the answer yet. Now, go ahead. Start. Okay. Now the quiz is active. Please choose the alternatives here. I hope you have read the question carefully. Time is up for this quiz. So now let me explain how you would go around solving a question like this. Now clearly the only case where they differ is if a value is null. So this obvious way of answering this question is to see what happens if r dot a is null. So in the first case, if r dot a is null, what happens? You will get less than 5 is unknown. In the second case, what will happen? R dot A less than 5, it is still unknown, and R dot A is not null will turn out to be false. Okay? So unknown and false is false. So now if you just look at these two expressions, it may look like they are different because one is evaluating to unknown and one is evaluating to false. But if this is all there is in the query, that is the where clause is exactly this, there is nothing more in the where clause, what is the impact on the query? As long as the final result is unknown or false, it does not matter, whichever one it is, the corresponding tuples from the from clause are going to get eliminated. So if you take the query as a whole, these two are actually equivalent. If you just look at the result of the where clause, well, they are not quite equivalent. So now what are the options? The two are equivalent, is actually what I intended, because I intended to say this is the full query, the result of the query. Okay? But I did not phrase the question properly, therefore that is not necessarily the correct answer. If you interpreted the question as if the final result of the query is it equivalent, the answer is 1, which several people have chosen. So that is a correct answer. Now the 2 is the 2 are equivalent only if r dot a is declared as not null. That is certainly true. Whichever way you interpret it, if it is declared as not null, this case cannot happen. Therefore, everything will be fine, and that is the majority choice, which is in this case it is the correct answer. And the third choice is they are equivalent only if r dot a is null, which is wrong. And they are never equivalent is also wrong, because we have just seen the cases where they are equivalent. Yeah. So if you chose either 1 or 2, that is an acceptable answer. If you chose 3 or 4, that is wrong. So that is it for that quiz. Let us move on. So the next topic for this morning session is aggregate functions. And SQL defines 5 basic aggregate functions, although many implementations add a few more of their own. The 5 basic ones are average, min, max, sum and count. So what is an aggregate function? It aggregates a bunch of data. So you have a set, and actually in SQL a multi-set, which may have duplicates. You have a multi-set of values. On that you compute some aggregate statistic. So here are a few queries which illustrate the use of the aggregate functions. Let's say select average salary from instructor where department name is compsci. What is this doing? First of all, it is going to apply the from and the where clause. So it is going to find instructors who are in compsci. Now there is a whole number of these. From these, it is selecting average salary. So it is going to get the salary values, which is a multi-set, and then it is going to compute the average and return one single value. which is the average salary. Now, that is a simple query. It's an average, or it could have been count, min, max, whatever you want. In place of average, it will work just the same. Now, in this case, we wanted the distinct values for the average to be correct. But there are cases where we don't want distinct values. So, take the next one, which is find the total number of instructors who teach a course in the spring 2010 semester. So, how many distinct people are teaching courses? So, how do we know who is teaching courses? Well, the teacher's relation tells us who is teaching. So, I can apply a selection on the teacher's relation, which says semester is spring, year is 2010, and I will find who all are teaching courses. Now, if I do a count on this, there is a problem though. What if somebody is teaching two courses or three courses? They will get counted multiple times. The question did not want that. The specification was how many different people are teaching courses. So, how do I deal with it? I'm going to say select count of distinct IDs. So, each of the aggregate operations has a distinct version where the keyword distinct is added inside the brackets. So, what is this doing? It's going to eliminate duplicate IDs. So, if a particular instructor is teaching two different sections or two different courses in a semester, it doesn't matter. The duplicate copies of ID are eliminated and then the count is applied. So, this is going to give me the correct count. There's another variant called count star, which is useful in many situations. It says find the number of tuples in the course relation. Now, I don't have to explicitly list the attributes, like which attribute do I choose. I could have chosen the primary key attribute. But instead of dealing with that, I can just say select count star from course. It counts how many tuples are there in course. I'm going to come back a little bit later to how aggregate functions deal with nulls. There are some complications there. So, I'll come back to it later after covering aggregates ignoring null values. So, getting a single aggregate value is certainly very useful, but there are many cases where I want to get aggregates per group. So, for example, I want to find the average marks for each course or the average marks for each exam in a course or the CPI, which is the total credits of each student. So, there are a number of queries like this which actually want to compute an aggregate per something. And the way you do this in SQL is by introducing the group by clause in addition to the aggregate function. So, let us take a simple query. Find the aggregate average salary of instructors in each department. So, each department should clue you in that I need to do it separately for each department. And therefore, in the SQL query, a clause is introduced which says group by department name. Now, what does this clause do? Well, the evaluation is done as follows. The from clause relations are evaluated, doing a cross product as required. Then the where clause predicate, if any, is evaluated. In this case, there isn't any. So, the from clause just has instructors. So, the result of the from and where clause is a set of tuples. Next, the group by is applied. What does the group by do? It breaks up the set into groups based on which tuples have the same value for the attributes listed in the group by. What is the attribute here? Department name. Therefore, we form groups. If you see the first table here, it has already been, it is the instructor relation, but already broken into groups. The first group is biology. There is just one instructor in biology. The second group is computer science. There are three instructors here. Electrical engineering has one and so forth. Physics has two. So, we have grouped it. Now, once you have done the grouping, the aggregate functions are applied separately per group. So, in the first group, there is just one row, but anyway, the aggregate function is applied on that row. The average salary happens to be 72,000, which is obvious. And the result contains what? It has department name plus the aggregate value. So, now you can include an attribute name here, it is okay, as long as either you are aggregating on it or that attribute is present in the group by list here. So, department name can be included. What if instead of department name, I said select let's say ID comma average salary and group by department name. There's a problem. In a particular group, there may be different values for ID. So if I say select ID, which value of ID can it choose? It can't arbitrarily choose one ID. I mean, there are 5 instructors in a department. Which of their IDs is chosen? It doesn't make sense. So that is actually disallowed in SQL. You can only list an attribute if either it is there in the group by clause over here, therefore we know its value is unique in a group, or that attribute is inside an aggregate function. So if there are many values, they get aggregated together into a single value. So moving on to this one, we have compsci with 3 tuples. So those 3 values and their average is 77,333, ignoring the decimal places. Electrical engineering is just 1 tuple, 80,000. Finance had 2 tuples whose average is 85,000 and so forth. So we get all the departments here with their average salary. Well, almost. What we get is all departments which have instructors. If a department does not have any instructors, what happens? Well, the group by was on instructor, therefore the department name will not appear here at all, and the department name will not appear in this result. Now, if you do wish that department name to appear, you have to do something more. You have to rewrite the query somewhat differently. We will see that later on. So this query is an erroneous query, which I told you on the last slide itself verbally, but here you can see it on the slide. It says select department name ID average salary from instructor group by department name. As I said, ID is not unique in a group, therefore this query would give you a syntax error. SQL would catch it at the before executing it. Now there's one more clause called the having clause, which is like the where clause, but it is applied after the group by and after the aggregate values are available. So over here, this query computes the average salary, and what it does in the having clause, it says, let's read the query. Let's read what the query is supposed to do. Find the names and average salaries of all departments whose average salary is greater than 42,000. So here's a predicate on the result of an aggregation. There are multiple ways of writing the query in SQL. The simplest way is to introduce the having clause, and therefore we say select department average salary from instructor group by department name. So far it's the same as the previous query, but the extra condition was we only want department names whose average salary is greater than 42,000. So we added having average salary greater than 42,000. So to understand this, the having clause can have aggregate functions, the where clause cannot. It is not allowed to have aggregate functions. That is the difference. The having clause is applied after grouping, the where clause is applied before forming the groups. What I would like to do is take a few minutes now for questions. And okay, Vidya Pratishthan.
Good morning, sir. Sir, I have we have a small query on clickers. So I would like to ask a question to clicker team. Most of the participants are not getting functionality of the clickers, which button is to be pressed and when the timing is going to be start. If there are the multiple questions are there, then how much time slot is given for the one questions and when to click the next button, that is not getting to our participants.
I can answer that question. Before I ask you to give the answer for a particular question, I am displaying that question and asking you to answer that specific question, and you get a time window. I am announcing when you should start pressing your buttons and when you should stop, when you can no longer press your button. So that is done manually at this point. So once I say you can answer, the assumption is that once it has been enabled here, all the clicker software at the local centers also gets that signal and starts accepting questions. Now it is possible that there is some delay in this thing going from here to the individual centers. So what I have been doing is actually giving you about 5 seconds after we start the reception here before I tell students to answer the question. So I hope that this 5 seconds is enough for all the centers to catch up and turn on their collection. I hope that answers your question. There is a question on chat which says, how do we retain the duplicates in relational algebra? The answer is, relational algebra could either be based on the set or the multi-set version, and the like I said, relational algebra is used essentially inside of database systems. It's not usually exposed to users, but most systems which do this have a multi-set version of operator, and they also have a duplicate elimination operator. So if you don't do anything, if you just use the multi-set version, the duplicates are retained. If you want to eliminate duplicates, you use the duplicate elimination operator, and that is what actually happens internal to the database system. Since this is not made available to programmers, you can't actually program on it. But if you wish to write queries in relational algebra and try it out, you basically have to define first which version of the relational algebra you are using. If you are using the multi-set version, you can introduce a new duplicate elimination operator, which is often called delta, D for duplicate elimination, in Greek delta, and that eliminates duplicates. I hope that answered the question. Okay, I just accepted Amrita Kollam. We are able to see you. Amrita Kollam, do you have a question?
If we want to store the data in Malayalam, okay, original language.
Okay, how do you store it? That's a good question. How do you store text in non-ASCII, that is in Indian languages, in a database? Today the standard is Unicode. So now there are two parts. One is how to get the text in Unicode. There are many editors today which will let you type in Indian characters. So you do have websites which let you do that. You have other editors in Linux, for example, in Windows, which let you enter text in Malayalam or Devanagari or any other Indian script. And that can be copy-paste. I'm giving you a very low-level description. If you, at the level of the database system, a string can be in anything. So you can give an insert a statement in SQL where the string is in Unicode. And as long as you've declared the type of that attribute to be ncar or nvar char, it will accept Unicode strings and store it in Unicode. So if you get the Unicode representation using whatever means from the input, and you pass that Unicode representation on through SQL, the database can store it if you declare it as ncar or nvar char. Or in Oracle, you'll have to declare it as var char 2. So if you do that, you can store it. Now, some versions of some databases do not support this unless you specify it as a database option somewhere. So if you run into trouble with this, look up the manual to make sure your database has support for this turned on. These days it is turned on by default, but some old versions may have the support turned off, and you may have to do something in configuring your database to turn it on. I hope that answered your question. If there is another question, please ask. Otherwise, please tell us over. Now let's try people on our high bandwidth server. So we have, okay, NIT Warangal, you are coming up next.
Sir, I want to know, what is the default behavior of nulls in ordering of the tuples? Can you change it? If so, how?
Okay, that's a good question. When you do order by, what is the default order of nulls? Now, the SQL language actually lets you specify whether null should go first or null should go last. And there is specific syntax for this. You can say nulls first or nulls last. And this is actually at the level of, so SQL has this whole notion of collation. And so for a particular type, you can say this is the sort order. And in this sort order, null should go first or null should go last. So you can look up your manual to see how to control this behavior. And again, if you don't say anything, what is the default? I'm not sure if database systems stick to the SQL standard. So my suggestion is you try it out on your database system and find out what it is doing. If you want to control it, you can do that. Again, look up the syntax on your SQL systems manual. So that's not a very complete answer. I'm basically telling you to go read the manual. But it's a good question. Do you have any follow-up questions?
How to get top end records from a relation?
That's a good question. How do you find the top few records from a relation? And the answer to that question is, there is something in the SQL standard which lets you do this. If I have time, I will cover it later. But there is also what is implemented in many database systems, which is a lot easier to use than the SQL standard. And this varies by database system. So in PostgreSQL, for example, there is a limit clause which you can add on at the end of a query. You can say limit 10. Now again, the exact syntax varies. So other databases may say stop after n rows or first n rows or whatever. So look up your manual to see exactly how to do it in your database. But since we are using PostgreSQL in this course, the clause is limit and whatever number you want to specify. Now the question is, which, supposing I say limit 10, which 10 rows are going to be output? If I don't have an order by clause, that depends on what ordering the query evaluation engine chose for a evaluating that particular query. Now that is not very satisfactory, because the 10 answers which I get may vary depending on what the optimizer did. So if I want to get something deterministic, I should really combine this with an order by clause and say order by something and then top end. So if I say order by name and then limit 10, I'm going to get the first 10 names in ascending order. Now SQL standard actually has a much more powerful way of specifying how to get the top n rows, where here the limit n is at the end of a query. So it is like ordering, it only applies to what the user sees. The SQL standard has other syntax, if we have time I'll get to it, which actually lets you do this inside of a query, get that result and then use it in a later part of the query. So I'll deal with that probably tomorrow if we have time. That is a good question. Are there any other questions?
For a department, if I want at least one course registered department, I'll be joining department and course. But yeah, if I want a department with more than two courses or three courses,
okay,
how would be the query?
Okay. I'm going to defer this to later, because we're going to cover subqueries in the second part. And with subqueries, it's easy to write a query like this. So I will cover this in the second half of it.